Good morning, Revolution Church. How's everybody this morning? Pretty good? Pretty good. Sorry about no red velvet donut king this morning. Anybody mourning that? Hey, man, what's up? How are you, bro? Hey, mama. Hey, baby. All right, so hey, listen, I want to do a couple things here with you this morning. Before we jump into the message this morning, I want to spend a few moments to clarify some. Apparently, this is just a little bit of confusion about something. It's kind of crept into our church a little bit. It's about our Wednesday evening gathering, okay? I just want to talk about that a little bit just so you can understand what's going on. So on Wednesday night, we have a potluck dinner at 6 o'clock, and then we go through this thing called the journey, okay? So people have asked about the journey. They want to come and be a part of the journey, and some people feel like they can't come, and some people think that they can. It's just like kind of confusing. But I want to clarify what this whole journey thing is, okay? So Jesus said that we're supposed to go make disciples, right? And baptize them and then teach them all that you've been taught, right? You understand that that's what we're supposed to do as a church? Okay, you understand that. Okay, awesome. So then, and then Paul comes along later on. He kind of clarifies a little bit about that. He says, listen, the things that you've heard me teach, I want you to pass those things on to trustworthy men and women, so in turn, they'll teach others. That's the discipling process, right? I teach you, you teach him, she teaches her. Like, that's what we do, right? And remember those ads? Was it Clairol or something? And so on, and so on, and so on. Old people, amen?
Amen.
Okay. So, here's the deal. Wednesday night's closed. You guys are fraternity. What's wrong with you people? Is it a click? No, it's not a click at all. Here's the deal, okay? We don't want people coming in to just learn. Like, I take the guys in the room, and the women go with my wife, Meredith, right? We don't want you to just come and have myself or Meredith teach you some things. Like, that's not the purpose of the church, right? That's not how you get an army going. What you do is you do what we did originally, is we made a sign-up sheet for the journey, and those who are interested in being discipled, that means taught who Jesus is, who you are now, what's salvation, what's the kingdom of God, what's the church, what do you do with all that? You come, you signed up, and we sit around the table and we teach you, right? And the whole effort is to teach you so that in turn, you can teach other people, right? So the problem in the church in America too often is that when you have a friend that wants to, say you invite him to church, and one of the songs gets them, right? It just gets them. Or something the preacher says gets them. And they're like, I want to get saved. So what happens is most of the time, the person that invited them will say, hey, well, let's go talk to the pastor. That's a mistake right there, right? Right? At that moment, that person who invited him should say, you know what? I can help you with that right now. Let's pray right here, right now, right? Let's get her done, right? And hey, you want to get baptized? I got a bathtub in my house. I got a pool at my house. There's a tank right there. Don't bring him to the pastor to get him baptized, because here's the deal. The Bible says that it's our job, the leadership of the church, is to equip the people to do God's work, right? I don't need to be baptizing everybody. I've baptized 250 people already. I don't need to baptize any more people. You need to baptize some people. You need to baptize someone. You guys need to baptize. That's what we're supposed to be doing. An army of believers going after the whole world. That's what we're supposed to do. And so what we want to do is just say this. The Wednesday night's closed, but discipleship is wide open. Right? Wide open. If you want to be discipled, if you want to learn what that book says, if you want to learn who Jesus is, if you want to learn about who you are now in Christ, right? Come see us. I want to do the journey thing. Awesome. I'm going to grab someone from the journey. If you're a man, I'm going to grab a man from the journey. I'm going to say, all right, see this dude that came into the church? He wants to be discipled. Joseph, go get him. That's what we do, right? And he goes and disciples, right? Or he goes, yes. Let them stay. That's cool if they just show up. But I want you to know, we're not being clicky. I'm not turning you away. I'm just saying, I don't need everybody to come to the table where there's, you know, 27 people around a table now, right? And it's always the same people, right, in the church. You ever notice that Wednesday night, right? Sunday night Bible studies, Wednesday night Bible studies, the same core group of people, right? We don't need that anymore. What we need is to get those people out there discipling some folks, right? So more people can know who Jesus is and the kingdom of God can advance. So I'll just say this. The Wednesday evening is closed, but discipleship is wide open, Does that make sense? We're all about that. That's the whole idea of this church, is to make disciples who make disciples. You got a chance to yell that out here when we do announcements later on, okay? So are we clear on that thing? We're clear on that thing? Awesome. Why don't you take a few moments before we get deep into the Word of God and encourage one another, right? That's what we're supposed to do when we gather, right? So let's take five. Get up out of your seat. Go say hello to somebody. Don't just come here and listen to me yell at you for an hour. Go make a friend. Tell them you want to meet them this week up here at the coffee house and have coffee. Invite them over for dinner. Babysit their kids. Let them know that they look great. Welcome them to your church. Hug their neck. Love on them. Made it. I love it. No, you're about to be. Hey, so there's this Jesus, right? There's this Jesus. Yeah, there's this Jesus feller. And, you know, Jesus, he did some things. Did you know that? He did some things and he said some things. And they were really, really amazing things. And because of those things, the people that were around him, that kind of gathered around him, you know, they responded to his things with some things of their own. And so that's why we're studying the book of Acts, right? We're studying to learn what, not just to fill our head with a bunch of knowledge. Hey, I knew that. That happened. That's awesome. That means nothing. The reason why we're studying it is because we want to know what response should look like, right? Anybody? Yeah. Just to let you know, like, you guys don't pay me a lot. I really get paid in amens. So if you just, like, I want to know that you're out there, okay? As a matter of fact, this front row, the people in the tables, that's the amen section. So it's kind of a prerequisite. If you sit there, I expect it, right? So we're looking, the reason why we're studying the book of Acts is because we're looking for two things. We're looking for truth shared, right? I need to know the truth, man, right? Don't you just need to know the truth? I find myself, parents, don't you find yourself sometimes talking to your kids and you, like, you know what they did, like they're trying to dodge it, but you know what they did, but you're trying to get them to train up to speak the truth and stop lying. So you tell them, listen, I'm not going to punish you. I just want you to tell me the truth, right? Anybody ever do that? Oh, yeah. My parents never had to do that with me. Lying. So listen, I just need to know the truth, right? I just want to know the truth, and the Bible talks about the truth a lot, but one place it says that we're supposed to worship God in spirit, like energy, emotion, your heart, strength, right? And in truth, right? You want to know who he is, right? And that's one of the reasons why we come to church. Definitely one of the reasons why we're studying the book of Acts. We want to know some truth shared, right? So not only can we frame our life, but we can share that truth with other people, right? The other thing we're looking for, two things, truth shared, example shown. I want to know what response to Jesus looks like, the right response, right? So Jesus is saying some things and doing some things and going to some places, and Luke records all that down in his gospel, Luke, and then he comes up with a follow-up book. And he says, okay, in my first book, I told you who Jesus is and what he said and what he taught and where he went and what he does. And then in my second book, I want to show you what people do in response to who he is and what he said. Get that? And so that's why we're studying the book of Acts. And so if you go way, 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 way back to the beginning, in the first weeks of our study, a couple months back, you see in Acts 1:8, here's a careful description of some truth shared and examples shown. He says, Acts 1:8, he lays the foundation for the entire church, for the entire book of Acts, for our response. He says, you will receive power from upon high. We learned what that was, right? Acts chapter 2, Pentecost, day of Pentecost. The power from upon high, what? What was that? That was the Holy Spirit coming, and now he's there with his people, and he drops onto the people and drops into the people. And now God of gods is living. That's kind of funky. But he lives inside of us now. He says, you'll receive power from upon high. And what will happen when this happens? And you will be my witnesses. What's that mean? Tell of who I am. Tell of what I said. Right? That's what you're going to be. You're going to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Okay, so do you guys like maps, right? I like maps. I was terrible in school, but I like social studies. Bring up the map. We bring up the map. Okay, you see it there? So, not to cheat the people on the other side, but look, here's Jerusalem, right? Step one right here, right? Jerusalem. So it's going to start in Jerusalem, right? And Jerusalem's within this area here called what? Judea, right? And so it's going to spread from here to all here, and then it's going to spread to, what did he say? Right, and then what? To the ends of the earth, right? That's the name of our study, the ends of the earth, okay? That's how it all happened. So let's just see if that thing played out. So when it all first starts happening, a power from upon high, that's Pentecost, that's the Holy Spirit dropping, and we see that happen in Acts chapter 2, right? And so that starts right there in Jerusalem, and then guys like Peter and John and all those guys, they start preaching and performing miracles, And the church begins, and an amazing supernatural community begins. And they start to gather every single day in the temple and in homes, and they're sharing everything that they have, and they're worshiping Jesus Christ, and they're praying and celebrating who he is. And, of course, there's pressure from the Jewish leadership there in Jerusalem, right? And then Stephen starts to preach. You remember that thing a couple weeks ago, right? He starts preaching Jesus, and what happens to that guy, right? He gets stoned to death. And so that's all in Jerusalem. And when Stephen preaches and gets stoned right then and there, it launches this grand-scale persecution of the Church of Jesus Christ. And it says that all the Christ followers, except for the actual apostles, but all the thousands of people had gotten saved at this point. And it says that all of them scattered to where? No. Where do they scatter? Come on, Bible scholars. Judea. Put the map back up. Right? Isn't that funny how that happened? They scattered to Judea and Samaria, right? But not because evil had busted up the crowd and it had won, because we learned in the scriptures that when they went to those areas, what'd they do? They started preaching, right? They started preaching. They became witnesses. They started telling people about who Jesus is and what he said in all of those areas that they went to, that, by the way, the leadership at the time who killed Jesus, they think this guy Jesus is dead, but now all of a sudden his plan comes to pass, and these people have gone to these exact areas that he said they would go to, and they're fulfilling the exact mandate that Jesus said they should fulfill, and yet he's dead. Maybe we're onto something here, right? Maybe we're onto something. And so step one, Jerusalem, you see it, right? Step two, Judea. Step three, Samaria, and then step four, right? Step four is to the ends of the earth. That's the name of our series. And let me tell you something. We, right here, right now, we are the ends of the earth. We are step four, right here. 6,500 miles away from Jerusalem, Jesus said this is going to spread to the ends of the earth, and here we are in Leesburg, right here this morning, celebrating Jesus Christ. We are step four. And so what I want to do this morning is I want to carefully examine the launch of step four, the launch of ends of the earth ministry. And I want to glean from the text this morning in Acts chapter 9. You can turn there. I want to glean from this text some wisdom that we are going to need as Christ followers so that we can be effective witnesses in this ongoing wave of Christ's ever-increasing kingdom. You guys ready for that? You want that? You want to be part of that? I do. Okay, Acts chapter 9, and I'm going to read 1 through 31. So it's a pretty substantial reading this morning. But we're a Bible church, and I know you love God's word. There we go. Someone's on it. Right there. Someone got it. You want to try it again? We're a Bible church, and I know we love God's word. That's what I'm talking about. So I'm going to read this, and you guys are going to love it the whole time, right? Every word, every word. You guys all there? You have a Bible in front of you? Let me see your Bibles. Let me see your Bibles. I love it. Nice. She's got a fake one and a real one. That's cool. Just messing with you. Messing. Alienate the first-time guest. It's the way we do it. That's why we grow so fast around here, right? Love it. All right, listen. Just kidding. Acts chapter 9. You ready? So meanwhile, Saul, and you're going to find out later on in Acts that this is Paul, the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul who wrote half the New Testament, okay? Meanwhile, Saul was uttering threats with every breath and was eager to kill the Lord's followers. If you have a Bible with some info down at the bottom, you're going to see these followers are disciples. Okay, so not just followers. I don't like that translation. Because some people just follow Jesus around even though they don't really worship him. They're just kind of in awe of what he does. And he's a disciple. We're making disciples. He didn't say make followers. He said make disciples, right? So Saul, Paul, was eager to kill the Lord's disciples. He wanted to kill the church, be done with it, right? So he went to the high priest. He requested letters addressed to the synagogues in Damascus, asking for their cooperation in the arrest of any followers of the way he found there. He wanted to bring them, both men and women, back to Jerusalem in chains. Like, that's what you do when you'd conquer another army, right? You didn't just arrest them. You didn't just kill them. You brought them into town in chains first to parade around with all of them going, look what we did. We conquered them. To shame them first, right? That's what he wanted to do. Verse 3, as he was approaching Damascus on this mission, a light from heaven suddenly shone down around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Who are you, Lord? Saul asked. And the voice replied, I am Jesus, the one you are persecuting. Now get up and go into the city and you will be told what you must do. The men with Saul stood speechless. And we need more of that in the church. In awe, Jesus Christ. The men with Saul stood speechless, for they heard the sound of someone's voice, but saw no one. Saul picked himself up off the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he was blind. So his companions led him by the hand to Damascus. He remained there blind for 3 days and did not eat or drink. Now there was a believer in Damascus named Ananias, not to be confused with the dude who got killed in Acts chapter 4 or 5. The Lord spoke to him in a vision, calling out his name, right? Ananias. Yes, Lord. Just a side note here, just something I observed. In verse 5, when Saul answered back,
He said, "Who are you, Lord?" And when Ananias answered back, he said, "Yes, Lord." Notice the first letter of the word Lord in these two verses. His sheep know his voice. You see? Lord for Saul was an important person that's speaking out of the sky and freaking me out. Lord to Ananias was, "Yes, God." Right? You see the difference? Okay. Verse 11, the Lord said, "Go over to Straight Street to the house of Judas," different Judas. "When you get there, ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul. He is praying to me right now. I have shown him a vision of a man named Ananias coming in and laying hands on him so he can see again." "But Lord," exclaimed Ananias, can I just give you guys some advice? Don't do "but Lord." I love this. "But Lord," I'm going to read the whole thing, but then look at the answer to the Lord. He's like, "Go." You ever do that when you're a parent, right? "But Dad, go." Right? That's what he's doing right here, right? Well, let's read it all. Let's fill it in. "But Lord," exclaimed Ananias, "I've heard many things about the terrible things that this man has done to the believers in Jerusalem. And he's authorized by the leading priests to arrest everyone who calls upon your name." So what is he saying there, really? He's got permission to arrest and kill me, right? "But the Lord said, go. For Saul is my chosen instrument to take my message to the Gentiles and to kings, as well as to the people of Israel." Do you ever wonder why Paul went through so much and never died? That's why. "And I will show him how much he must suffer for my name's sake." So Ananias went and found Saul. He laid his hands on him and said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus who appeared to you on the road." Imagine that. This guy must be freaking out of his mind, right? This guy shows up. Can't see nothing. A dude with the name that he got in the vision knows exactly what happened. Wow. Right? "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus who appeared to you on the road has sent me so you might regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." Instantly, something like scales fell from Saul's eyes, and he regained his sight. Then he got up and he was baptized. For all those people that have a line on the order of things, you know, you get saved, you get baptized, you get the Holy Spirit. You get saved, you get the Holy Spirit. You get baptized, you get saved, you get baptized, and you get the Holy Spirit. Like, okay, can you just throw out your little framework that you try to put God in? Because it'll wreck you if you read the book of Acts, okay? Because it's every which way, the way that God wants it to happen in that situation, that's how they get saved, okay? So let's not put an order to all that, okay? Saul stayed with the believers in Damascus for a few days, and he immediately began preaching about Jesus in the synagogues, saying, "He is indeed the Son of God." All who heard him were amazed. "Isn't this the same man who caused such devastation among Jesus' followers in Jerusalem?" they asked. "And didn't he come here to arrest them and take them in chains to the leading priests?" Saul's preaching became more and more powerful, and the Jews in Damascus couldn't refute his proofs that Jesus was indeed the Messiah. After a while, some of the Jews plotted together to kill him. They were watching for him day and night at the city gate so they could murder him, but Saul was told about their plot. So during the night, some of the other believers lowered him in a large basket through an opening in the city wall. When Saul arrived in Jerusalem, he tried to meet with the believers, but they were all afraid of him. Duh. They did not believe he had truly become a believer, right? Don't we all have people like that? Yeah. There's no way that guy. There's no way that girl. I know what she did. I know what he used to. Please, right? Yeah, I'm that guy too. So we need to get off that one, right? Hey, thanks. Appreciate that. Thank you very much. You're kind. Thoughtful. Thank you. Where are we? Oh, they didn't believe that he truly become a believer. Then Barnabas, see, we need to stop identifying ourselves and other people by what they used to do. You know what I mean? Isn't that the gospel? Just eraser, start over. Bank robber, murderer, divorced. Used to do this, used to do that. Listen, I used to sell drugs. I used to sell porn. Used to take them, used to watch them. Used to sell cars. I'm your pastor. Does that encourage you a little bit? Or does it make you want to run out of here? Probably both. But right? Isn't that the way it's supposed to be? Cleared, cleared, cleared. Found not guilty. Then Barnabas brought him, Paul, Saul, to the apostles and told them how Saul had seen the Lord on the way to Damascus and how the Lord had spoken to Saul. He also told them that Saul had now preached boldly in the name of Jesus in Damascus. You see the change there, right? And so Saul stayed with the apostles and went all around Jerusalem with them, preaching boldly in the name of the Lord. He debated with some Greek-speaking Jews, but they tried to murder him also. They're trying to kill this dude. You think you got it hard, right? When the believers heard about this, they took him down to Caesarea and sent him away to Tarsus, his hometown. The church then had peace throughout Judea, Galilee, and Samaria, and it became stronger as the believers lived in the fear of the Lord. You know, if you've been around here for a while, you know I'm a big fear of the Lord guy. And people preach that you don't have to have that anymore. New Testament church, right here, book of Acts. They lived in the fear of the Lord. And that brought peace. Okay. So just remember that. He is a loving God, but he's also God. Okay. He's God. And with the okay, so let me start that over. The church then had peace throughout Judea, Galilee, and Samaria, and it became stronger as the believers lived in the fear of the Lord, and with the encouragement of the Holy Spirit, it also grew in numbers. Okay. So, Jerusalem, step one. Judea, step two. Samaria, step three. And ends of the earth is step four. And what we see here is the beginning of step four as the gospel moves from Jerusalem to that area, Judea, a little bit north into Samaria, and now it's going to bust north. If you look at the map, you see where Damascus is. Do you guys see Damascus? Right up there, top right corner. Do you see it right there? Okay, that's where the gospel is getting ready to go right now. So you can see exactly what Jesus, the dead guy, said is going to happen. It's happening just as he said it would happen, okay? So let's just touch the elephant in the room for a second, the obvious thing, okay? Let's take a second and preach the exact same message that you've heard 1,000 times in church about Acts chapter 9, the greatest conversion of Christianity since the church first began, right? Where you hear like, hey, Paul was killing Christians, and have you killed any Christians lately? No. Well, so that means you're not as bad as he is. And so if God could save and use Paul, then certainly he can save and use you as well. I'm encouraged. Aren't you encouraged? I'm super encouraged. Paul understood this whole truth. He understood that he was wretched and awful. And why this message that gets preached all the time is truth. It's not just someone making anything up. 1 Timothy 1:15, Paul says this, Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, and I'm the worst of them all. Right? I'm the worst. I killed Christians. I'm the worst of them all. And then the verse goes on, he says, and he did this so that others can believe and receive eternal life too. So he gives you this amazing comparison. Look at, I am filthy, disgusting, worse than any of you, and God saved me, and he's using me in a powerful way, so therefore you have hope that he can actually use you. And so that's super encouraging. So there, look, the same message you've heard a million times in church about Acts chapter 9 just got preached 1,000,001 times. Okay? But listen, there's so much more. There's so much more. Are you ready for the message title? Are you ready for the message title? Okay, we're going to put it up on the screen here in a second. And when we put it up on the screen, I want you to all read it out loud together. You ready? Are you ready? 3, 2, 1, go. There's so much more. Step number four. There's so much more to this. There's more to Acts chapter 9. There's so much more to ends of the earth ministry than just because Paul got saved and can get used, you can get used by the Lord as well. So I got four things more about step number four. You ready for the first one? So the first one, the first truth that we see here in the text is that there's more to reaching people with the gospel than saving souls. Okay, there's more to reaching people with the gospel than saving souls, right? Heaven promised is awesome. Anybody excited about heaven? I'm excited about heaven, right? No more sorrow, no more tears, no more sickness, no more death, no more automatic dialers for your car warranty for my 1999 Subaru with an oil leak and 175,000 miles. No more automatic dialers for your student loans that you don't have, right? Heaven's going to be great, y'all. It's going to be great. But listen, the goal of most evangelism is just this: get them saved. They call it soul winning, right? Win some souls. Win some souls. That's super important. But there's more to it than that. There's way more than that. Let me just pause for a second. Think about this. Did you know, there's a point in this. Did you know that we are not called Christians until Acts 11? So from the time the church started in Acts chapter 2, when the Holy Spirit comes and starts to dwell in the people and the church launches, between that chapter 2 and Acts chapter 11, I'm sure I could figure out how much approximately time, if I did a careful study of time, the time frame there. I didn't do it this week. But there's some time that goes by, right? Whether it's weeks or months or years, I'm not quite sure. But we definitely know that some days on the calendar have been flipped, right? But did you know, from the time the church started until the Christians in Antioch, we were not called Christians? In verse 2 of our reading, you saw what we were called. Followers of the way. Followers of the way. You see, a Christian isn't simply a saved from hell, heaven promised guy. He or she is a person that lives a certain way in light of eternal promise. Do you see? That's the difference. The reality that I want you to embrace this morning is best described not by me, but by the Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, where he says, if anyone is in Christ, if anyone has bent the knee to Jesus Christ, and you're part of his family, if anyone is in Christ, they're a new creation. The old has died. Behold, that means I get to see something. Behold, the new person. Right? They're a new creation. It's not just something that you put into your back pocket and you become a Christian in heaven one day. No, behold, the old has died. There's a new creation that he speaks of now, right? Followers of the way right now, okay? It's different. So being a Christian isn't as much about a future destination as it is a present transformation. Right? That means when you're in Christ, you're a new creation. That means it starts when? Right then and there, right? That means the person you were before you bent the knee to Jesus, that person's gone. That means you have new perspectives. That means you have new affections. That means you have new desires. That means you have new priorities. The things you used to do aren't at the top of the list anymore. Maybe some are lingering. Maybe some need to be demoted. Maybe some need to be cut off completely, but they're not at the top of the list anymore. You start wondering, why am I sitting here listening to Toby Mac music? I used to like this other stuff. What's going on with me? Right? Things change. Things change. Instead of Sunday morning sleeping in, Sunday morning going fishing, you find yourself sitting right here. What in the world is happening to me? Right? It's a new person. And all this newness should shape how you live, okay? And listen, loved ones, look at me. If this isn't happening in increasing measure, I love you, but I would say to you this morning, question whether you're even saved. I'm not here to condemn or any. Listen, if your affections for Christ and your desire for him and desire his kingdom aren't increasing and old things passing away, you have to wonder if you actually have been reborn. And so if that's the case, if those things are not increasing in your life, today would be a great day to bend your knee to the lordship of Christ and go after him with your whole heart. You could do that right here, right now, today.
okay? Now, what would that look like for you and you and you and every person? I don't know. It's going to be a little bit different for all people, but listen, we're not making anything up. I'm not going to just kind of give you some checklist of what you need to do. Listen, Jesus came in the flesh. Jesus came in the flesh so that we could see the way that he lived, so we could see the way that we should live, right? How we should think, what we should say, where we should go, who we should hang out with, what we should spend our money on, our time on, our thoughts, everything. We should just see what Jesus did, then we'll know how we should live. So in a sense, not in its entirety, but in a sense, Christianity is more about living than it is about dying. The main question in American evangelism needs to change from where are you going when you die to how are you living while you're here. That's most important. And listen, if you want to influence people so they can be secure about where they're going to be when they die, then make sure the priority is what you're living while you're here. That's the greatest influence on them, okay? So that needs to change. Followers of the way, right? They loved unconditionally. They gathered daily to pray and study and to rejoice and to share all that they had with one another and to encourage one another daily. They shared Jesus generously, right? And boldly daily. They shared all that they had boldly and daily all the time for the good of the entire church. Jesus, listen, Jesus is the Lord of followers of the way, okay? He's the Lord. That means, listen, this is when you can help me. When he says jump, you say what? No, you start jumping. Right? That's what you're supposed to do. You don't even ask questions. Remember when he said, but Lord, what did he say? Go! Right? Don't ask how high. Just, you know, be like Abraham. How high? Remember? When he said go, what did he do? Packed his stuff and left. He didn't say, but God, I need to know where I'm going. No. Start jumping. That's lordship. When Jesus, you have to confess him as Lord. That doesn't mean you say it with your mouth. That means you live it with your life, okay? That's confessing with your mouth. People that follow the way, they follow the Spirit's promptings. They obey his word. They think as Jesus thinks. They speak as Jesus speaks. They love as Jesus loves. They forgive as Jesus forgives, right? That's what God wants for you and me, right? He doesn't want us to just be Christian by name, not just Christian by our future, not just Christian by I'm a Christian by my bumper sticker, right? No, he wants us to be Christian by the way that we live. So the question I would have for you this morning as we close up the first section of our message is, if a wave of persecution came across America, would they haul you off and put you in chains and in jail because they knew that you were a follower of the way? Look at your life. Look at your priorities. Look how you spend your time, your money, your thoughts, your attitude, your mouth. Every single thing that you do, would you be persecuted as a follower of the way? Would they identify you as a follower of the way? If not, it's time to change. Okay? It's not just some future hope. It's the way you live now. That's what matters most. Okay? Identity matters. The way you live matters. Okay? All right, so here's the second thing. Here's some more truth. Here's an anchor for your identity right here, right now, okay? This is an anchor that if you can get your brain around this thing and you can embrace it deeply as your reality, it's going to bolster your faith and it's going to inspire you do in your part to do step number four of ends of the earth ministry, reaching people for the kingdom of God, okay? So if you look in Acts chapter 9, look at verses 4 and 5. Well, 3, 4, 5. As he was approaching Damascus, this Saul, on the mission to persecute the church,
A light from heaven suddenly shone down around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Who are you, Lord? Saul asked. And the Lord replied, I am Jesus, the one you are persecuting. Okay? So I want to offer this to you for your consideration. With that in mind, you know when someone asks Jesus, what's the most important commandment? You know, love the Lord God with all your mind, heart, soul, and strength, and then what? Love your neighbors yourself, right? What does that mean? Like, people always have confusion about that, because I have too. Like, what does that mean? Love him as myself. I don't even like myself. What am I supposed to do? Like, what do I do? What does that mean to love him as I love myself, right? It's kind of confusing. Can I just offer you that I think that verse, that commandment is really attached to what Jesus is doing right here. I believe, and you can research this and pray through it and look at the scriptures, and I hope that you'll do that. I said that when Jesus says love your neighbor as yourself, I think he means love people as I love them. And let me tell you why. We know practically that Paul was not literally arresting and imprisoning and killing Jesus at that point, right? Like, really, you know what I'm saying? Like, Jesus had already gone to the cross, and he had gone to the grave, and he ascended and all that stuff, and he's not standing right there. He was persecuting people, right? Followers of the way. However, what Jesus says here is truly remarkable. He says, Paul, when you hurt Kaylee, you hurt me. When you hurt Cindy, you hurt me. When you hurt Herb, you hurt me. Do you understand? When you hurt Richard, you're hurting me. And the same is true in Matthew 24. Let me get the scripture right. 25. Jesus says the opposite too. He says, listen, when you fed one of mine that was hungry, and when you gave one of mine a drink when they were thirsty, and when you gave one of mine clothing when they were naked, and when you cared for one of mine when they were sick, and when you visited one of mine when they were in prison, you did it to me. So when you see these two truths in Scripture, don't you see the intimate, close, intertwined, connected relationship that Jesus sees between you and him? Right? That's how he sees you, right? You're not some number. You're not some statistic. You're a son. You're a daughter. And when you hurt, I hurt. He literally feels your pain because you're that close to him. You're that one with him. See, we view him, and this is encouraging to me, and I need this too, because I view him in a lot of different ways, right? He's the creator, and you can visualize him like this being maybe speaking, and the planets existing, and then you see the commandments, and you see the Red Sea, and you see Jesus, and he's multiplying bread, and all these different ways we see Jesus. But how about seeing him this way? One with you. Would you do me a favor? It's kind of crazy, but would you just wrap your arms around yourself? Just hug. That's his. Those are his arms. That's what he feels. That close. Right? That's how he feels about you. And this anchor to Christ should also anchor us to one another. Here's what I mean. Romans 12:5 says, in the same way we who are many are one body in Christ. Okay, I got that. And individually members of one another. Do you see that? That means that when Jerome hurts, I hurt. When Star hurts, I hurt. That means we rejoice with those who rejoice. We mourn with those who mourn. That means we share one another's burdens. Christians are to love one another so deeply, so connected in lasting, tangible community that the world will see something that they've never seen anywhere else. And the Bible says that they will know us by the way we love one another.
And see, that's the way Jesus feels about you. When you hurt, he hurts. He's that close to you that he actually feels your pain. Do you ever feel the pain of somebody else? I mean, people that are married can kind of get a glimpse of that. And when your spouse is sick or hurting or upset, you just hurt for them, right? But we're the bride of Christ. And so when you hurt, he hurts. When you rejoice, he celebrates with you. You're that close. That's who you are. That's an anchor for your soul, man. You get a hold of that thing, it changes everything. All right, so here's the third thing I saw there in the text. I hope you see it too. I'm going to read something from the book of Hebrews. In Hebrews chapter 5, I'm going to read something. What I'm going to read in Hebrews 5, 11 through 14 is kind of like a sledgehammer to a lot of people that hear it. Okay? Are you guys ready to get hammered in church? Who wants to get hammered in church this morning? I want to get hammered in church this morning, okay? Different kind of hammering. But it's our third point. You'll see it. You ready? 11 through 14, Hebrews chapter 5. There's much more we would like to say about this, so you can read if you want to at another time about what he was talking about. He's teaching him some stuff, right? But it's difficult to explain, especially since you are spiritually dull and don't seem to listen. I mean, he's writing to believers here, man. Hammer. You have been believers so long now that you ought to be teaching others. Instead, you need someone to teach you again the basic things about God's word. You're like babies who need milk and cannot eat solid food. For someone who lives on milk is still an infant and doesn't know how to do what is right. Solid food is for those who are mature, who through training have the skill to recognize the difference between right and wrong. Okay, so I'm not going to be Francis Chan, come up here with a milk bottle like he did, and tell everybody that they suck. Because he did that. Go online. He used this text and he had a bottle and he said, "You guys suck." You know what he meant. I'm not going to say that. But here's the main point of this, and then I'm going to tell you what the third point is. Look there in verse 12 again. You have been believers so long now that you ought to be teaching others. Instead, you need someone else teaching you the basics. I love being here doing this. This is what God's called me to do, and I am so grateful that there's eager hearts here this morning with notebooks open and Bibles and pens, and you want to learn, and I want to help, and that's awesome. But can we just have some honesty in church this morning? It might be a little bit embarrassing, but if we're not transparent, we can't grow. Show of hands, how many people have been to church 50 times or more in their life? Just show me your hands. 50 times or more in your life. Awesome. How many people in this room have read all four Gospels? Raise your hand. Just raise your hand. Just be willing to be embarrassed. Who cares? You've read the Gospels. That's awesome. You know what that means? That means that right now, you have a greater knowledge of Jesus than Paul did. Now, he had a great background in theology, Hebrew theology, but what we call nowadays the study of Jesus Christ himself, the person and work of Jesus, is called Christology, okay? So you have a greater grasp on Christology, on the person and work of Jesus Christ, than Paul did when this happened, when this went down in Acts chapter 9, okay? But watch Paul set us an example, okay? Pick it up in verse, Acts chapter 9, verse 18. Instantly, something like scales fell from Paul's eyes when Ananias came and laid hands on him, right? He regained his sight. Then he got up and he was baptized. Afterward, he ate some food and regained his strength. So this is just happening, right? He's wet in the waters of baptism. He just had this happen. Paul stayed with the believers in Damascus for a few days and watch. And immediately, he began preaching about Jesus in the synagogues, saying, "He is indeed the Son of God." He just got saved. He's wet from the waters of baptism.
He had just got his eyesight back. He's probably tired. He hasn't eaten in 3 days. Just had a meal, right? And he still has this massive reputation of a sinful, nasty lifestyle. And what does he do? Preaching. Preaching, right? Preaching publicly. Not a whole lot of Christology. Got some theology. He knew about this Messiah that was to come. He had lots of Jewish, Hebrew, Torah training. He knew that there was someone coming, but he didn't know a whole lot about Jesus. He had only met him for, what, 5 minutes? But he knew enough to say this: Jesus is the Son of God. In the book of 1 Corinthians, Paul says, when he said, when I came to you, my message was plain, it was boring, it was just this. Listen, I just forget everything else except Jesus Christ and him crucified, right? Jesus Christ is the Messiah you all been waiting for. He got killed for you. Give your life to him. That's my whole message. Amen. That was it, right? He didn't have a whole lot, but he had that. And so he began preaching immediately. And not just preaching publicly with no pressure. We saw in verse 23 and 29 both, they're trying to kill him for it, right? Anyone out there trying to kill you for being a witness for Christ? They're trying to murder him. Listen, I was thinking about this too, like, it said that they waited day and night at the city gate waiting for him to kill him. You know, like, that city in Damascus, that wasn't like New York, where you could get away with some stuff. My guess is it was probably like Eustis or less. It's not hundreds of millions of people in the little town of Damascus at the time, right? So they're waiting for this guy, and he has to sneak out of the city through a hole in the wall through a basket, right? They're trying to kill him. So what happens to this guy who's getting pressured to stop preaching, or we'll kill you? Does he slow down? Does this new follower of the way, does he slow down? As a matter of fact, he takes it to a new level. Look at verse 25. This is a bad translation here. Another one of these thought-for-thought translations in this Bible, which is okay, but I knew it was kind of watered down, so I looked it up in all the other translations. It doesn't say that so during the night some of the other believers, most of them say, so during the night some of his disciples lowered him in a large basket through the wall. Right? So why, he wasn't just preaching in the temple. He's making disciples. He's gathered up some people around him, and he's sitting down, and he's reasoning with them with the scriptures about who Jesus Christ is, training them up to get ready to go and launch new works and new churches and evangelize to the ends of the earth. That's what Paul's doing. Listen, immediately when he got saved, he didn't know a whole lot about Jesus Christ yet, but he knew he was the Son of God. He knew he was the Messiah, and so he gave his life over, even with threats of death. I'm giving my life to this. And he starts to do exactly what he says. He's taking this truth that he knows, and he's sharing it with other trustworthy men and women that they might share it with other people. So we take what we have, and we share it with those that we know. And that's the idea behind our journey on Wednesdays. We're taking what we have, we're sharing it with a group of people, and then they are in turn looking for new people that will walk through that door, and you will go to them and you'll say, brother, thank you for coming, and I'd like to get to know you, and let's have coffee, and I'd like to take you back to page one of the journey, and I'd like to take you through and disciple you so you can be equipped to go do the work of the ministry. Amen? We don't wait till our knowledge library is bursting at the seams before we'll be willing to say yes to Christ's great commission to go make disciples. He said, go make disciples, y'all. He didn't say, sit around on your fanny for 10 years, going to church, listen to the fired up guy until you maybe get fired up, and then maybe you'll go talk to somebody. He said, go make disciples, man. What does that mean? Go make disciples, man. So if you just got saved, maybe you just got saved. Well, maybe you just got saved, and you got a testimony, though. Right, you got a story. Just like Paul had, right? He didn't have a whole lot, but he had a story. This is who I was. This is who Jesus is. And this is who I am now. And he's no respecter of men. He'll do what he did for me. He'll do it for you too. Right? That's our story. You don't have to know a whole lot. Paul shows us you don't have to know a lot about Jesus to preach boldly and effectively. Amen. And most people don't know a whole lot about Jesus. That doesn't mean you can't be powerful. That doesn't mean you can't influence your neighbors, your friends, your coworkers, your family. You could have a massive influence and not know a whole lot. Listen, when I got saved, I just said yes. I didn't know much. I still don't. But I know enough to get up here once a week and yell at you for an hour. Right? I didn't know much when I got saved. You said yes. You didn't know anything about Jesus. All of a sudden, you're sitting there in church, and you're sitting there weeping like a little baby girl, and you don't know why. And you just give your life to Jesus. You didn't have all the answers. You just knew you were wretched and he was awesome and he could help you. And you said, yes, I'll do it. You didn't know anything. So what makes you think you need to know everything now to just go tell people that you're a weeping pile of tears and you don't know why? That's cool, right? Just tell them. Just tell them, just like Paul did. But listen, if you've been coming to church for a year or 5 or 10 or 20. Well, then you've been what the author of Hebrews would say, you've been trained. You've been trained. How many people have been in this church for a year listening? Right? You've been trained. Every week I just say, open your Bible too. This is what it says. You've been trained. You've been trained. You've been equipped to do the work of the ministry. Open your mouth. Right? Open your mouth. That's what we have to do. You've been equipped. That's three things. I said we had four, right? So here's the last step for help. Step four is what? Ends of the earth ministry. Reaching people, advancing the kingdom, growing Christ's church to the ends of the earth. Every single man, woman, and child to bend the knee to Jesus Christ, right? So look at the result of effective disciple making. You see it there at the very end of our reading this morning. Look at verse 31. So he's preaching, he's making disciples, and it says here, the church then had peace throughout Judea, Galilee, and Samaria, and it became stronger as the believers lived in the fear of the Lord, and with the encouragement of the Holy Spirit, it also grew in numbers. So I want to point something out to you. Growing stronger, being a better church, doesn't necessarily mean numerically. Because he separates it here. He says that they grew stronger and they grew numerically. You see? Both. That's the sweet spot of biblical Christian church. Right there. Deep and wide. That means you guys that are already here are growing in your understanding, your love, your affection for the Lord and each other, and your evangelism is more powerful. And as a result of that, then it grows in numbers as well. So an effective church is not only more mature in their understanding of God's word and the author, the Lord himself, and they're growing in numbers. Do you see that both there? That's what an effective church should look like. Deep and wide. Deep and wide. Someone say but. But, look at verse 16. Go back. It's on the heels of, this is all happening. This is awesome. Deep and wide, deep and wide. It's growing, growing, getting stronger. It's growing in numbers. The church is increasing. But look at verse 16. God says, Jesus says, I will show him how much he must suffer for my name's sake. So listen, loved ones. The sweet spot of a wonderful church will come at a cost. And it's better to know that going in so that when it does get hard, you don't split. See, a lot of people are under the impression that, you know, we get this rockin' church and all these people come and it's just this big old party. But in this life, you will have trouble, right? Many of the afflictions of the righteous. they come. Peter said, don't be surprised by the fiery trials that you're going through as if you didn't expect them to happen. It comes at a cost. If you want to see his kingdom advance in your lifetime, in your community that God has placed you in, it's going to come at a cost for you. It's going to come at a cost for me. It's not easy. And this is the part that nobody really likes to hear. But if Christ's kingdom is to advance and you've made him, genuinely made him the Lord of your life, then he's asking a lot of you. He's demanding a lot of you. You will suffer to do this. But I can tell you that suffering can turn to joy. Because when you realize, like Paul, that I'm in jail to bless the Lord and so that you guys can be saved, when that trumps his own personal little desires and you can find joy in that, if you can find joy in your jail cell that replaces the joy of your next big screen TV or your iPhone 11 or your next new car or your next big house or your next this or your next that, if you can find joy in the jail cell, it's really not suffering anymore. You know what I mean? I could tell you just from my own experience that, and I'm not very good at it all the time, but I kind of got there, kind of, not there yet, right? Pray for me. But, you know, I used to sell cars. We used to sell cars, and I used to make a lot of money. And now I don't make anything. I make what my Jewish family would call bupkis. I make bupkis, right? But the joy that I have in young men and women coming to know the Lord and serving him and watching their posts on Facebook about how they're studying the Bible at night and they rejoice in Jesus no matter how rough their life is, that's awesome. You guys don't know that I'm talking about them, do you? Right? When that stuff starts to be more important than your next iPhone, it's not even suffering anymore, right? It's not even suffering anymore. But if we want to see Christ's kingdom come, it's going to cost you. I don't know what that cost is going to be. I don't know what sacrifice you need to make today to change, to be different, to serve him instead of serving yourself. I don't know what that looks like. Everybody's different. But why don't we do this? Why don't we take a few moments and why don't we just pray, right? Let's just let the Holy Spirit tell you what that's supposed to look like, right? I can't tell you. I know this. In God's word, we see Jesus. We see what he did. We see what he taught. And that's our example, right? And when we see Paul, we see what he did. We see how he taught. We see Peter. We see all these guys. So we know what the example looks like. But we don't know exactly what it's going to look like for you. And it's going to be different for me than it is for you, right? Everybody's different. But I believe in the Holy Spirit. I believe that he exists. And I believe that he speaks to his people. And I believe that you may hear a voice. I believe you may just sense something swell up in you that says, you know what, I could just cut out this in my life. That'd be him too, right? Maybe you're sitting here and we're about to pray and all of a sudden a Bible verse or a story in Scripture pops up of a person in the Bible that did a certain thing for the Lord. And maybe that's him telling you, you need to do a certain thing like that for me. I don't know what it's going to look like. But why don't we take a few moments and we'll pray, right? And then what we're going to do is I'm going to ask this, I need 5 men to come up here. Come on, 5 men. And these guys are going to hand out communion.